Well, good morning, everyone. I'm pleased to join Senator Capito in calling this hearing to order. And I want to thank each of our witnesses here today for your willingness to share your perspectives on the cyber vulnerabilities that our infrastructure systems face. We're joined this morning by leaders who will discuss cyber vulnerabilities in our highways, our municipal drinking water, our wastewater, rural water systems, as well as inland waterway systems. A warm welcome to Sophia Oberton, to John Sullivan, to Shailen Bhatt, and to Evan Pratt. We're also delighted to be joined today by two of our colleagues, one a former governor colleague that I served with as governor for many years, our friend Angus King here in the Senate from Maine, and Representative Mike Gallagher, and they serve as the co-chairs of the Cyberspace Solarium Commission, the bipartisan intergovernmental body created in 2019 to develop a strategic approach to strengthen our defenses against cyber attack. Both Senator King and Representative Gallagher have provided invaluable leadership on the issue of cybersecurity. And we're pleased to welcome them here this morning. Thank you both very much for joining us. Especially I want to thank a ranking member Capito this morning for suggesting this hearing in the first place, and for her work and the work of her staff in helping to put it all together. All of us gathered here today understand the importance of protecting our nation's critical infrastructure. Yet in the past year alone, we've witnessed several major cyber attacks that have hobbled critical systems across our country. Unfortunately, no government agency or industry is immune to attacks from the vast array of bad actors who seek to undermine our security and profit from our vulnerabilities. We face threats from unscrupulous individuals, from criminal enterprises, and antagonistic state actors 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's unclear that many of our nation's vital transportation and water systems face especially serious challenges in dealing with cybersecurity vulnerabilities. A 2019 report from FHA, the Federal Highway Administration, stated that, and I'm going to quote them, "The Department of Homeland Security considers the transportation systems sector to be one of 16 critical infrastructure systems so vital to the United States that their incapacitation or destruction would have a debilitating effect on security, on national economic security, and on national public health and safety." It's not hard to imagine how they came to that conclusion. If we look at our highways, our tunnels, our bridges, we can see that they are dependent on vast interoperating computer systems, each with their own vulnerabilities to cyber attacks. We should also be increasingly concerned by the mounting cybersecurity challenges facing our nation's drinking water and wastewater systems. According to a 2019 report by the American Water Works Association, cyber risk is the top threat facing U.S. water sector today. Just 1 year earlier, the Department of Homeland Security and the FBI warned that the Russian government was specifically targeting the water sector and other critical infrastructure as part of a multi-staged intrusion campaign. Cyber vulnerabilities on our water systems represent unique national security challenges. A major breach in our water infrastructure system could jeopardize the safety of our drinking water and impair communities' ability to safely dispose of harmful waste, threatening human health. The cybersecurity of our inland waterways is yet another area that requires our attention. Approximately 15% of all domestic freight moves through our intercoastal and inland waterway systems. Safeguarding of this system is vital, not only for our economic activity, but also for effectively protecting our communities from flooding. These threats are large in scale and require widespread collaboration, and I'm looking forward to hearing from all of our distinguished witnesses today on how federal and state agencies can work together with industry and community leaders to strengthen the cybersecurity of each of these vital parts of our infrastructure. But before we do that, let me offer some observations up front. There's no one-size-fits-all solution to all the different cyber threats facing our critical infrastructure systems. At the federal level, we should build flexibility into our solutions so that state and local leaders have the tools they need to effectively address their unique cybersecurity challenges. At the same time, we must also recognize that many local government agencies and infrastructure systems face significant challenges in just fulfilling their core missions. Therefore, any federal assistance in cybersecurity should be structured to help these entities remain focused on their core missions. Finally, I believe it's incumbent on us to recognize that cybersecurity is a long-term, constantly evolving challenge. Addressing this challenge requires sustained federal investment, not one-time solutions. With that, I'm happy to turn to our ranking member, Senator Capito, for her opening remarks. I want to thank her again, her and her staff, for coming up with this idea and helping to make it happen. Senator Capito.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all the witnesses that are here and thank my colleagues, Senator King and Representative Gallagher, for being here with us today. We look forward to hearing from you on the best ways to protect our physical infrastructure from cyber attacks. I think it's a very timely hearing, as we've seen attacks here in the last several months, how the federal government can partner with industry, state, and local partners, and what gaps we have that are leading to our vulnerabilities. This committee has a leading role in ensuring the safety and security of our nation's core infrastructure system, and we're committed to being a strong federal partner in tackling the most challenging issues that cyber threats present. We must work together, and I think we will, on this issue to find solutions that will safeguard the whole of our core infrastructures, which include our water systems, our port and inland waterways, flood control infrastructure, highways, bridges, and tunnels. The speed of advancing technology and the improvements this has on our day-to-day lives of all Americans is extremely positive in a lot of ways. We are working towards a more modern and a more connected transportation system. This does, however, create a level of urgency for implementing strong cybersecurity measures. On our roads and bridges, vehicles and infrastructures are becoming more connected and smarter, which these types of advancements increase data and access to that data can result in safety and privacy threats. It opens our transportation system up to vulnerabilities that didn't exist in the past. To help address these types of threats, our committee passed the Surface Transportation Reauthorization Act of 2021, in which we expanded eligibilities under the National Highway Performance Program, NHPP, and the Surface Transportation Block Grant Program, STBGP. We all have little initials for everything, for cybersecurity protections, and added a requirement for the Federal Highway Administration to develop tools to assist transportation agencies in protecting and recovering from cyber incidents. And I think it's important that we have the capacity. A lot of our local systems don't have the capacity to really meet these challenges and need some assistance. These provisions will help to protect our highway, bridges, and tunnels against emerging cyber threats and protecting our critical transportation infrastructure. Cyber attacks are also a growing threat to our water and wastewater systems. We've seen a growing number of these systems fall victim to these attacks, which have significant implications on public health and safety. These attacks are very scary for the public when you think about your water system being invaded when they occur and can leave us questioning the safety of our water systems. I'm proud of the work this committee has done so far to address cybersecurity vulnerabilities in drinking water and wastewater systems. The Drinking Water and Wastewater Infrastructure Act, which passed out of this committee unanimously and was approved on the Senate floor by a vote of 89-2.
How much?
89-2. Includes provisions that provide funding for protections against cybersecurity vulnerabilities to our water systems all around the country. Though I'm proud of our work, there's more work to be done, and the chairman talked about this. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses on the ways the federal government can act as a better partner in protecting our drinking water and wastewater systems from cyber attacks without costly mandates that can distract from the core mission of providing safe, reliable, and affordable water service to the American public. The physical infrastructure of our ports, inland waterways, and flood control systems are also potential targets for foreign adversaries and cyber criminals pursuing ransomware attacks. Hacking of these systems can harm our economy and pose threats to human life, property, and the environment. Providing the tools to the government agencies, industry partners, stakeholders responsible for protecting our critical infrastructure from cyber attacks is essential. Maintaining resiliency against cyber threats is also an ongoing and ever-evolving process. As the chairman said as well, and a little bit differently, but it's not a one-and-done event. We cannot put blinders on and think we've finished everything when we come to envisioning potential threats. because we know those threats change daily. Government agencies such as the Corps of Engineers have been partnering with other agencies and local communities to address cybersecurity for our infrastructure. We need to continue to support training exercises and information sharing between agencies to protect our critical infrastructure, such as the electrical grid, our water systems, transportation systems, and emergency response systems. I expect that the committee will continue to include cybersecurity policies in our WERDA bill, which we're beginning work on. That's the never-ending story WERDA bill. And as we have in our transportation, drinking, and wastewater legislation. I look forward to hearing from our witnesses today about the best practices and key challenges facing the security and safety of our transportation systems and how we can work together towards protecting all of Americans and critical infrastructure through strengthened cybersecurity measures. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Cavanaugh. Well said. And now we're going to turn to our witnesses, our colleagues, and welcome our first panel, which is comprised of our distinguished colleagues, Representative Mike Gallagher, whom I don't know well. Happy to see you again and to welcome you today from the Badger State of Wisconsin. I'll never forget, as a 17-year-old freshman to Ohio State, I pledged a fraternity in homecoming. We were playing Wisconsin at the homecoming football game. Football's a big deal at Ohio State. And we erected about a two-story high Badger, paper mache Badger, in front of our fraternity. And I think I got to put the halo or something on top of it. And I've learned from an early day in my life what the Badger State was all about. And then we went out and crushed Wisconsin. No, I don't think so. But anyway, we're glad you're here and delighted that Angus is here. And Senator King and I had the privilege of serving as governors together, and it's great to be able to work here on all kinds of issues that are important to our country, especially this one. But these two gentlemen currently serve as co-chairs of the Cybersecurity Solarium Commission, which was established by the 2019 National Defense Authorization Act to develop a consensus national strategy to counter significant cyber attacks. Working together, Representative Gallagher and Senator King have provided crucial leadership in defending our nation from cyber threats. And so we're very pleased that they could join us this morning to share their insights with us. So thank you both. I'm going to ask Representative Gallagher if you would lead off and for Angus to follow in turn. So thank you both very much for joining us.
Well, thank you, Chairman Carper and Ranking Member Capito. It's an honor to be here. I won't spend any time talking about my college fraternity experiences because they all make me disqualified for office.
It's a PG audience. So.
Exactly. It's also an honor to be here with my good friend and fellow Solarium co-chair, Senator Angus King, who I've worked incredibly closely with on this project over the last few years, and really learned about the importance of securing our nation's water supply from cyber attacks. In the course of our work, we paid special attention to our national critical infrastructure and the importance of securing that infrastructure from both criminal and nation-state cyber threats. It is my observation and the Commission's observation that the 16 critical infrastructure sectors are not equally equipped when it comes to cybersecurity. There are leaders, like the financial services sector, and there are, quite frankly, laggards. Despite the importance of our water systems, the water and wastewater infrastructure sector lags behind many of its peers, posing a risk to our public health and safety. And in the report we submitted to Congress in March of 2020, the Commission concluded that water utilities remain largely ill-prepared to defend their networks from cyber-enabled disruption. As we've continued our work on improving the nation's cybersecurity, bolstering the ability of the water sector to detect, prevent, and withstand cyber attacks has emerged as a crucial priority. Though 55% of utilities responding to a survey conducted by the Water Sector Coordinating Council rated cybersecurity as a high or top priority, the overall cybersecurity of our water sector remains immature. A 2016 National Infrastructure Advisory Council report highlighted the wide disparity in the technical capabilities and resources of water utilities across the country. Many of our nation's nearly 70,000 community water and wastewater systems are small, publicly owned assets that are not equipped to deal with nation-state threats. And the National Infrastructure Advisory Council has described the federal support for the resilience of the water sector as, quote, fragmented and weak. Municipalities have benefited greatly from the enhanced efficiency and quality brought by automated and remote systems for treating water supplies, But those same systems introduce new risk when not properly secured, as can often happen when budgets are tight and must be balanced. Investments in security can fall by the wayside. The Water Sector Coordinating Council reports that 38% of utilities dedicate less than 1% of their budget to the cybersecurity of information technology, and 44.8% allocate less than 1% of their budget to the cybersecurity of operational technology. This leaves the water sector vulnerable to nation-state and criminal adversaries and insider threats, and gives them the ability to disrupt our critical infrastructure. So against these threats, the water sector faces challenges ranging from maintaining awareness of threats, to assessing risks, to identifying and remediating vulnerabilities. A shortage of qualified cybersecurity professionals across the world compounds the problem, making it very difficult for resource-strapped organizations to attract and retain the talent necessary to protect our drinking water and our public health systems. Earlier this year, for example, the city of Oldsmar, Florida, suffered a cyber attack in which malicious actors attempted to change the level of lye in the city's drinking water. Though the attack was quickly detected and stopped, the situation could have been disastrous. In another incident, a malicious cyber actor compromised a California water treatment plant, deleting crucial programs meant to treat drinking water. And in April, federal prosecutors unsealed a grand jury indictment of a former employee of a Kansas water utility who remotely tampered with the utility's cleaning and disinfecting procedures. It was through sheer luck that none of these incidents affected customers. A more sophisticated adversary could impact the safety of thousands of Americans through a cyber attack on our water supply. And beyond the direct impact of drinking water, a cyber attack affecting the water supply could have cascading impacts for other critical infrastructure sectors that rely on clean and safe water to function properly. That's why it's considered a lifeline sector. These incidents underscore the importance of protecting our water systems and the need for more coordinated, consistent federal action to ensure that water utilities have the people, processes, and technology necessary to protect our public health and safety. Investment in the sector's cybersecurity must match the importance of the sector to our national security, our economy, our public health, and our safety. So with that, I just want to thank you again, Chairman Carper, Ranking Member Capito, and the members of this committee for the opportunity to discuss this pressing issue with you, today. We appreciate your attention to this matter. And with that, I would like to turn it over to my Cyberspace Solarium Commission co-chair, Senator Angus King.
Thank you, Congressman. Senator King, please proceed.
I once appeared before a middle school group with my friend Stephen King, the other King from Maine. And a little girl raised her hand and said, "Do you ever have nightmares?" And Stephen King's response was, "No, I give them to you." That's my job today, to give you a nightmare about the vulnerability of our water systems. This is an extremely dangerous situation. I believe that the next Pearl Harbor, the next 9/11, will be cyber. And we are facing a vulnerability in all of our systems, but water is one of the most critical and I think one of the most vulnerable, and that's why we, Mike Gallagher and I, thought it was important to come and talk to you today. We have to reimagine conflict. For 1,000 years, we've thought of conflict and wars as army against army, navy against navy, battles out in some other place. Conflict now is almost entirely in the cyberspace area, focused on the private sector, on non-combatants, if you will. And that's why we're in a different way of thinking about this kind of issue. And we have to think about a new relationship between the government, particularly the federal government, and the private sector. 85% of the target in cyberspace are in the private sector. In this country, I was on a panel recently with Kevin Mandia, who's one of the real private sector experts. He's the head of FireWire, the guy who really discovered the SolarWinds attack. He said, "We live in a cyber glass house in this country. We're the most wired country in the world. That's good. But we're also the most vulnerable country in the world." North Korea, I don't think, has to worry too much about cyber attacks because they don't have much in the way of connectivity. Everything in this country is connected, and water is a target. As Representative Gallagher just mentioned, we know of attacks in Florida, in California, in Kansas. There was one, a serious one in Israel recently. And wherever there is an automated system for controlling chemical flow, which there is in virtually all water systems, there's a vulnerability. Our adversaries, be they criminal syndicates or nation states, are never at rest. And Chairman Carper, in his opening statement, talked about how this has to be a sustained effort. There's no single solution. We've got to continue to up our game because our adversaries are upping their game. In terms of the water systems, we have good news and bad news. The good news is our systems are fragmented and scattered. In other words, it's not like the electric grid where an adversary could take down a whole region of the country. The bad news is because they're so fragmented, 70,000 of them, rarely do they have the wherewithal or the knowledge to fully protect themselves so they can be picked off one at a time more easily than the grid, which has a high level of protection and a high level of sophistication. The ranking member knows all about what can happen when a water system goes bad, as it did in Charleston some years ago. It wasn't a cyber attack, but it was a kind of warning of what this can mean and how serious it can be for a community. So what are the solutions? I should mention that our commission worked, we're still at work. We had our appalling 44th meeting this past Monday. So we're still at it trying to define what the solutions are. There are federal solutions in terms of organization. We just appointed our first national cyber director 2 weeks ago. There are a lot of those things that are going on. But in an area like this, protection begins at the desktop. We could do everything right here in Washington, and goodness knows we don't, but we could, but still be vulnerable if one official in one desk in Dubuque in the water office clicks on a phishing email, then we're sunk. And that's the danger. So there has to be a system of tech support through the Department of Agriculture, through your programs, tech support for these programs. There have to be standards, and there has to be testing. There has to be somebody who, if I were running a water system, I would hire an outside group to try to hack me to show whether or not I'm vulnerable. Most CIOs say, yeah, boss, we're okay. I don't think we are. And the only way to determine that is by what's called penetration testing, which is actually hackers for hire, friendly hackers, to determine where your vulnerability lies. We need to talk about systemically important critical infrastructure and setting up an environment. In our report, we called a joint collaborative environment where the private sector and the government can share information in real time with confidence and trust that will enable us to bring to bear the resources of the federal government and also to allow the private sector to have some liability protection if they're going to share information and have this relationship, because a week later doesn't work. So to go back to the beginning, there is an incipient nightmare here, and it involves all sectors of our critical infrastructure, but water, I think, is probably the most vulnerable because of the dispersed nature of water systems in the country. So I commend this committee for attending to this issue. Look forward to working with you as we try to work through the solutions and to have our game at the level of our adversaries. This is a potential nightmare, but it's one that we can wake up from if indeed we wake up. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
We should pay you for coming and testifying. Well, that was terrific. That was just terrific. Actually, we do pay you for coming and testifying. I would say to Congressman Gallagher, Senator Capito and I love working with this your colleague here on a lot of issues. And whenever I have the opportunity to co-sponsor a bill with Angus, I always insist that his name goes first. And that people can describe the legislation as King Carper. So. You think I'm kidding.
I've always talked about it with Tom Cotton, King Cotton, as a kind of ring.
All right. Gentlemen, I know you don't have anything else to do today. So, no, I know you've got a lot of other things to do. Thank you so much for your leadership on this and for taking time to kick us off this morning. Thank you. And with that, I think our second panel is welcome to take your seats. All right. I think I've had a chance to shake all of your hands this morning. Senator Capitum, I had a chance to personally welcome you. And it's great. Some of you we know very well, Shaylin, and others not as well. But we're delighted that you're able to find time in your schedules to join us. I'll take a minute or two to introduce our witnesses. First, let me introduce Shaylin Bott, who's not a native of Colorado. He's not a native of Delaware, but in the past, he served as Secretary of Transportation for both of those states, and we are grateful for his service. I know Hick, we call him Hick, Governor Hickenlooper, Senator Hickenlooper, for whom you worked, was grateful for your service. And in addition to literally serving as a DOT head at two states, Shaylin has also served as an Associate Administrator. This is impressive. I learned some things I didn't know, Shaylin. But an established government service as associate administrator at the Federal Highway Administration. And I mentioned Secretary DelDOT as executive director of Colorado Department of Transportation. And the list goes on. I won't go through everything, but thank you for an extraordinary record of public service. Let me also introduce John Sullivan. Mr. Sullivan, good to see you. And chief engineer for the Boston Water and Sewer Commission, do you have a favorite baseball team? Okay, thank you. All right, good. I think I know who it is. I'm a solid 49-year veteran of the commission. Is that true?
Yes, that's correct. I'm in my 50th year, and I re-signed up for five more.
God, I love that. I love that. Well, anyway, thank you for all those years of service. And I understand you serve on a number of other boards, leading national and regional organizations dedicated to the advancement of water delivery systems and pollution control. And next, I want to introduce Sophia Oberton. You pronounce it Sophia or Sophia?
Sophia.
I'll get it right. All right. Sophia, welcome. Public Works Department Special Project Coordinator for the town of Del Mar, Delaware. Sits right on the, Ben Carden knows, sits right in the Delaware-Maryland line. And half of it's Delaware, half of it's Maryland. We call Del Mar the town too big for one state.
That's correct.
That's where we go. Delaware has a unique jurisdiction with town departments that provide services to residents on both sides of the Delaware-Maryland state line. Ms. Oberton is a licensed water operator in both states who also serves as the safety coordinator for the town of Del Mar. Welcome. Which side of the border do you live in?
I live on the Maryland side.
I'm sorry. Ladies, time has expired. Not really. Finally, I want to introduce Mr. Evan Pratt, the Water Resources Commissioner in Washtenaw. Is it Washtenaw?
Washtenaw, that's there correct. The first people's name.
Oh, good. Washtenaw County, Michigan. As Commissioner, Mr. Pratt oversees a range of programs and services, including design, construction, and maintenance of county drains, as well as emergency flood response and maintenance of lake water levels, to name just a few of his many duties. Mr. Pratt is also the chair of the Huron River Watershed Council Board of Directors and president of the Michigan chapter of the American Public Works Association. One of my great thrills in my life is to throw the opening pitch at Tiger Stadium the last week the Tigers played at Tiger Stadium.
Oh, I was at that game.
It was so exciting. I always wanted to be third baseman for the Tigers, and after I threw the pitch, I went over and I stood on third base, and I said, this is mine.
Yes.
And they closed the stadium that week. All right. There's been some years since then they could have used me at third base,
yeah.
But not this year.
Well, I spent 6 years drinking Mr. Sullivan's water, so I'm kind of a Red Sox fan as well.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. All right. We're grateful you're all here. We look forward to an enjoyable hearing and informative hearing, and one that'll maybe excite and get us on the right path and so we do address these really significant challenges. Shailen, I'm going to introduce and recognize you first for your statement, and then we'll follow on in order. Okay, Mr. Secretary Shailen Bhatt.
Good morning, Chairman Carper, Ranking Member Capito, and members of the committee. I am honored to be here today. On behalf of ITS America members working to secure transportation assets, thank you for recognizing the growing risk and making cybersecurity explicitly eligible in the committee's FAST Act reauthorization bill. For the past 100 years, surface transportation has primarily consisted of individual, independent vehicles traveling on asphalt. In other words, cars and trucks moving on, over, and through roads, bridges, and tunnels without the benefit of intelligent transportation technologies. 20 years ago, in addition to causing a tragic loss of life, the 9/11 attacks were a wake-up call that focused our attention on the vulnerabilities of U.S. infrastructure. When I was with the Kentucky Transportation Cabinet in 2005, we had deployed sensors and CCTV to monitor critical roads and bridges. At that point, data was still largely siloed and fragmented, but soon these transportation data systems converged. Shortly after that, connected vehicles, along with faster and more reliable broadband, entered the equation. In the last decade, we have seen another convergence. The smartphones and other devices that have been so helpful in our daily lives were introduced into transportation. State and local transportation agencies began to modernize their informational and operational technologies, overlaying their physical infrastructure with a digital layer. They began to use real-time data and predictive analytics to operate the system with more efficiency and functionality, which led to safer roads. Today, we're on the cusp of a digital transformation in transportation. The Internet of Things, electric vehicles, V2X, and other emerging connected vehicle technologies, autonomous and automated technologies, and mobility on demand. While advances have made the transportation system more connected than ever, this connectivity brings increased cyber risks, and these risks have the potential to threaten the system, the economy, and people's lives. In the last 3 years alone, we have seen a 900% increase in attacks focused on operational technology use in traffic management signaling systems across the country. ITS technologies are making our system safer and more efficient. By moving people, data and freight, they support the U.S. economy. We must, however, secure our critical infrastructure assets and manage the vulnerabilities that come with a more complex system. ITS technologies play a critical role across the country, in cities and suburban and rural areas, and not just with passenger traffic. Let me give you an example of the critical role technology plays in supporting our economy. Think about a truck delivering freight from South Carolina's Port of Charleston to West Virginia's capital city of Charleston. Traffic management software efficiently helps the driver maneuver out of the port and through city traffic. Automated enforcement allows inspections to happen at 30 miles per hour instead of the driver stopping. Smart truck parking helps the driver find a place to rest and maximizes his or her hours of service. Electronic logging devices collect those hours of service. GPS technology can adjust routing based on weather and traffic information. These are just a few of the examples of technologies that improve safety and efficiency, and they must all be safeguarded. Just as we have underinvested in roads, bridges, and tunnels over the last two decades, the same is true for cybersecurity. We have not made the necessary investments to protect our transportation system. Developing a resilient system begins with cybersecurity. We should take it just as seriously as we do with other industries. As a former DOT director for two states, I'm very familiar with making tough choices about how to spend scarce resources. Public agencies must take an enterprise risk management approach by assessing and analyzing risks and making decisions accordingly. We recommend a more robust national transportation cybersecurity strategy to make the digital layer of our transportation system safer, much like how Vision Zero makes our physical infrastructure safer. We can do this by ensuring transportation agencies meet certain marks determined by the National Institute of Standards and Technology and the Center for Internet Security. We should treat cybersecurity like other safety programs, fund it at 100%, and provide technical assistance and best practices. In addition, we should help rural transportation agencies and areas of persistent poverty or income inequality. And let's allow flexibility in how transportation funds are used to invest in future cybersecurity workforce capacity. This is a critical opportunity. We have a playbook. If we provide the necessary resources, we can level the playing field and create a more safe and secure transportation network. We should give cybersecurity the same level of support that we give other safety programs. DOTs need resources to shore up their infrastructure. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today. I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
Thank you, Secretary Abbott. Now we're going to turn to Mr. Sullivan to provide his testimony. And Ms. Overton, you are batting on deck. You're on deck. All right. Go ahead, Mr. Sullivan.
Thank you, Chairman Copper, Ranking Member Capito, and members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify on cybersecurity challenges facing the nation's critical infrastructure. I'm John Sullivan, Chief Engineer of the Boston Water Sewer Commission. The commission is the largest and oldest water system of its kind in New England and provides drinking and water and sewer services to more than 1 million people daily. Today, I'm testifying on behalf of the Association of Metropolitan Water Agencies, or AMWA, which is an organization representing the nation's largest publicly owned drinking water systems. AMWA's members collectively serve more than 156 million Americans with quality drinking water. In addition to serving on the boards of AMWA and other state and national groups, as well as on the Water Sector Coordinating Council, I also chair the Water Sector's Information Sharing and Analysis Center, better known as the Water ISAC. AMWA operates Water ISAC on behalf of the water sector. It is a nonprofit organization established in 2002 by National Water and Wastewater Associations at the urging of EPA and the FBI to provide utilities with critical information on physical and cybersecurity threats and best practices for prevention and response. Water ISAC members currently serve 203 million people across the United States. While EPA and Congress provided some funding to get the service up and running, today member dues support 100% of the Water ISAC's budget. We know that water utilities pose attractive targets for cyber attackers. We're all aware of the well-publicized intrusion against the water utility serving Oldsmar, Florida, earlier this year. While utility staff immediately observed the breach and took corrective action to prevent any impacts to water quality or public health, it's easy to imagine how the outcome could have been much worse. The Boston Water and Sewer Commission had its own experience with a cybersecurity incident last year in a form of a ransomware attack. While it complicated day-to-day business and was costly to recover from, there was never any threat to public or environmental health due to precautions such as our business network being segregated from our control system. This is a best practice in any sector that uses industrial control systems, but this approach is not consistent across the sector's 50,000 drinking water systems and 16,000 wastewater systems. With such a large universe of water systems across the country, many are bound to have a lack of understanding of these cyber best practices or a lack of expertise and equipment to implement them. This is where the Water ISAC can help. In Boston's case, the center was instrumental in our recovery from our incident, as it referred us to a firm specializing in ransomware incident response, which helped us navigate our way through the event. Expanding the reach of the Water ISAC would therefore enable more water systems to be better prepared to respond to their own incidents. As Congress thinks about new oversight of cybersecurity at water utilities and critical infrastructure more broadly, we support an approach that incorporates the advice of subject matter experts from the water sector, as well as lessons learned from other sectors. The nature of cyber threats is ever-evolving, and a binding requirement that makes sense with today's technology could quickly become outdated in years ahead. Any regulatory oversight of the cyber sector's cyber activities must therefore remain as nimble as possible. One promising model for legislation could be found in the Energy Infrastructure Act approved by the Senate Energy and Natural Resources Committee last week. That proposal would encourage electric utilities to bolster their cyber preparations and would seek to increase participation in the Electricity Information Sharing and Analysis Center, Water ISAC's counterpart for the electric sector. A similar direction for the water sector would have EPA take steps to bolster water sector participation in the Water ISAC, especially among systems serving fewer than 100,000 people. This would help us get threat information and best practices into the hands of more small systems across the country. In closing, I want to note that my written testimony offers some feedback on water sector cybersecurity provisions in Senate 914, the Drinking Water and Wastewater Infrastructure Act approved by this Senate this spring. While AMWA believes these provisions were well-intentioned, we have identified a number of issues that could prevent the proposal from working as envisioned in its current form. We would be happy to work with you to address these issues. Thank you for the chance to testify today, and I am happy to answer any questions.
Mr. Sullivan, thank you, and thank you for your extraordinary service. 49 years, that's very impressive. Ms. Overton, please.
Good morning, Chairman Carper, Senator Cardin, and members of the committee. I am Sophia Overton, the Special Projects Coordinator with the Town of Del Mar in Delaware and Maryland. We have a population of approximately 4,500 persons. I hold a Class 4 drinking water operator's license in both Delaware and Maryland. In addition to managing the town's public drinking water supply, I am also the town's safety coordinator. I am honored to testify here today on behalf of small and rural communities in the United States through my affiliations with Delaware, Maryland, and National Rural Water Associations. I'm joined by my mother, Mrs. Linda Anderson, and the town of Del Mar's town manager, Mrs. Sarah Bynum King.
Would your mother just raise her hand, Ms. Anderson? Thank you.
Before getting into the substance.
We could see her lips move when you spoke, but that would be a lie. She's wearing that mask.
Before getting into the substance of my comments, I want to personally thank Senator Carper and Cardin for being such good friends and supporters of rural Delaware, Maryland, and rural USA. The rural and small town provisions in your recent legislations, DWEA 2021, are very much appreciated. And Senator Carper, you made us so proud when you chose to announce the legislation at Delaware Rural Water Association headquarters in Milford in April. The town of Del Mar would like to sincerely thank Congress for the funding we received under the American Rescue Plan Act. We received $3.7 million for the entire town. Much of this funding will be earmarked for water and sewer projects. My main messages here today regarding cybersecurity protection of small and rural communities' public drinking water infrastructure is, first, small communities only operate to serve the public interest. We are owned and governed by our local citizens through the elected local governments. We only exist to serve the public and are eager to take all feasible and necessary actions to protect the cybersecurity of our public drinking water supplies. Second, most U.S. community water systems are small, like my town of Del Mar. 91% of the country's just under 50,000 community water systems serve populations less than 10,000 persons. 89% serve populations less than 3,300 persons. That means approximately 90% of the country's public water supplies are smaller than my town, and I'm about to explain the rudimentary nature of Del Mar's water cybersecurity. However, any successful cyber attack on a small community that results in drinking water contamination would cause psychological panic in a national scale. This is why small communities believe that protecting our water supplies from any cyber attack is just as important as protecting large communities. In Del Mar, we don't have a SCADA control system or interface with the internet regarding our water infrastructure. On the other hand, we do have automated well pumps, disinfection injection, corrosion control technology, and pressure monitoring systems. If one of the water treatment technologies is not functioning properly, we receive an alarm message on our cell phone, and we must get to the appropriate part of the treatment facility to directly adjust the system. We want the committee to know that when towns like Del Mar need help in operating our water utilities, understanding new and complex federal water requirements, receiving the required training to maintain our licenses, and learning about the latest cybersecurity practices, we call on our rural water associates and ask for assistance from their circuit rider technical assistant providers. These circuit riders will travel directly to our town and focus on our particular issue with our specific water utilities. Just this past April, a circuit rider from Delaware Rural Water and another from Maryland Rural Water came to Del Mar and spent the entire day helping us complete the very complicated EPA-mandated risk assessment. I can't imagine how many days this approximately 50-page assessment would have taken us to complete without the direct technical assistance of the circuit riders. We may have been forced to pay a consulting engineer to complete the assessment for us, which would likely cost over $10,000, a massive unplanned expenditure for a town our size. Our greatest threat identified within the EPA assessment is likely the physical disruption of the water supply. However, our most significant issue, from our perspective, is the lack of personnel to operate and maintain the public water supply, fulfill the mandatory compliance testing and reporting, and respond to the typical small-scale emergencies in the water system, such as line breaks and leaks. We also need to replace our old and failing terracotta sewer lines, which are causing a severe INI problem for the wastewater utility. The reality is that small towns have limited financial resources, which must be targeted to meet our greatest needs. Any cybersecurity program should be scalable, meaning must recognize the complexity of water cybersecurity systems in small communities like Del Mar is not remotely similar to a large community. In closing, Mr. Chairman, I want to thank you again on behalf of small and rural water communities for your continued help and assistance.
What is INI?
INI is the inflow and infrastructure of water going into our sewer systems from manholes and our old terracotta pipes.
All right, thank you. Okay. Okie doke. Thank you for your testimony. Thanks so much for joining us here.
Thank you.
And Senator Cardin, I'm sure he'll want to welcome you personally and when he is able to join us in a little bit. I think that takes us to Mr. Pratt. Evan, we used to have a congressman, a senator named Evan, a governor named Evan, Evan Bayh. It's a great name, great colleague. Happy you're here. Welcome. Please proceed.
Yeah, thank you very much, Chair Carper, Ranking Member Capito, and members of the committee. I'm Evan Pratt, on behalf of American Public Works Association and our more than 30,000 members across America. I do appreciate the opportunity to provide this testimony today with some wonderful peers at this important hearing on cybersecurity vulnerability for America's physical infrastructure. As background, I spent my career in public infrastructure. I have a fancy degree from MIT, and I've been a licensed engineer for 30 years. But I
worked. What was your degree there from?
There you go.
What was your engineer?
Civil and environmental engineering.
We
yes,
have
sir.
A mechanical in our family from there.
Oh, there you go.
I could barely spell MIT. The idea of having a kid go there is pretty amazing.
Just remember it's Tim backwards in the mirror.
That's so great. That helps a lot.
Little mnemonic device, right? So I'm a frontline person. I currently serve as the Water Resources Commissioner for Washtenaw County, Michigan, with about 370,000 people. But today I'm testifying on behalf of APWA, the only association to serve and represent all areas of public works, both public and private sector, and providing expertise at the local, state, and federal levels. A lot of smarter people than me, I'd say. Cybersecurity is an increasingly important part of protecting our critical infrastructure assets and our citizens, and I'm embarrassed to say today I'm here because I and many of my peers know we are behind on cybersecurity, and we need help from you. You're going to hear some things that Representative Gallagher said, and I don't think either of us hacked into our systems to steal our speeches, but boy, he had a lot to say that is right here. So we're first responders in public works. We embrace our responsibilities as on the front line, preparing for, responding to, and recovering from disasters, all while protecting that critical infrastructure that's out there. And I think you all understand critical infrastructure is the roads and the bridges, sewer plants, water plants, flood control devices, drainage systems, and of course, the cyber systems that are sometimes used as controls to operate these. So for purposes of today's hearing, I kind of want to focus on that area. So we heard about the industrial controls in the water business. They're known as SCADA systems, which stands for Supervisory Control and Data Acquisition. We use this stuff to manage systems and to make decisions. So it's pretty important to a lot of systems. We all know flood control systems are critical too for mitigating severe weather, and it is essential for Congress to consider shared strategies to save our communities from potential attacks on these increasingly automated and connected systems. And as we do appreciate, as many have thanked you, Congress can and has supported America's critical infrastructure through continued and flexible federal funding, financing, and regulatory streamlining to help ensure that our agencies have the resources to protect against cybercrime. I'll say in 2016-17, I was part of a governor's bipartisan task force to assess the condition and funding needs of all infrastructure in the state of Michigan using a risk lens. To be clear, the overall purpose of the report was to bring that ROI that infrastructure brings right into focus, right to our state economy, into community quality of life, and that report's still used today. But there was not a single recommendation about cybersecurity, nor did we ever discuss it in talking about all the needs for infrastructure. The bottom line is we're trying to play catch up right now. And again, I'll talk a little bit later about where we could get help. So as Sophia said, I've learned and observed since then, cybersecurity is a big issue. On the one hand, not all utilities have remote sensing and controls. On the other, the wide range of SCADA solutions for the many who do may result in weak points when deployed, particularly with varied levels of agency cyber awareness that you've heard about today, and even more especially in the very common situation where agencies like mine can only meet their SCADA needs by stitching together several different tools, having homemade applications, and then there's a gentleman or lady who's on call at home, and they might be operating this from a bring-your-own-device type of situation. My county will give people $80 a month for the phone, and you're on call, and you got to operate the system. That's how you're going to be doing it. So you can picture there's a lot of the more handoffs, the more fumbles. Let's just say how that goes. So at the end of the day, you've heard about the nation having its fair share of attacks, whether it's SolarWinds, Colonial Pipeline, or other intrusions attacking those SCADA systems like Oldsmar and Post Rock, Kansas that have been talked about today. I'd just like to summarize the risk. You've heard about the 50,000 water systems, nearly 70,000 water and sewer plants across the U.S. I'll say that again, that's 70,000. I don't know what 0.1% is of that, even though I got a fancy degree, but it's a number that affects people, like in Del Mar. So one of those goes bad, and as was mentioned, that can cause a nationwide panic just with one of those 70,000 systems. So there's a lot of vulnerability there. So in closing, APA recommends the following, and again, we appreciate this committee has supported many of these things. First, the federal government must share threat information and provide interagency technical support, perhaps by establishing a voluntary national cybersecurity guidelines, something to supplement the Water ICE Act that's been talked about. Second, let's standardize and utilize important tools to protect these critical areas, including SCADA systems. Third, comprehensive cybersecurity training for old guys like me and my peers is real essential. That's something that we need to have more of out there so the awareness is greater. Fourth, please continue to fully fund FEMA's Emergency Management Performance Grant Program. Fifth, let's encourage effective asset management strategies to help deliver best taxpayer value. That's why we use these controls, because we can more efficiently operate these systems and get more bang for the buck. Sixth, let's continue to ensure that cybersecurity is specifically eligible for all the funding this wonderful committee provides. My agency has a history of more than 30 revolving loan funds for resilience and flood control, water quality, infiltration, and all of that. And our seventh thing is to basically lift that cap on private activity bonds for water infrastructure and restore advanced refunding of tax-exempt municipal bonds. This helps both local cybersecurity funding as well as taxpayers when we can get better interest rates. My last one that APWA requests is I hope Congress continues to ensure state and local control regarding public works projects. Locals are experts on their community needs. We do thank this committee for holding this important hearing and allowing me to provide testimony. And like everyone here has said, APWA stands by ready to help however you need us. Thank you.
That was great. Thank you so much, Mr. President. Senator Capico is going to lead us off on our questioning. So, Shelley.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank all of you. Very, very interesting. I want to start with just kind of a quick question to Ms. Oberton. You mentioned in your testimony that you're a Class 4 drinking water operator's license in Delaware and Maryland. Is there any cybersecurity training that goes along with obtaining one of those licenses?
None.
So there's a gap right there. And that's probably, I don't know, Mr. Batt or maybe Mr. Pratt, do you know other levels? Is there ever any cyber training that goes along with any of the licensures?
I've gone to lots of training. I've given lots of training with various professional organizations. I've never attended a cybersecurity class, and I can't recall seeing one on an agenda. Perhaps they are out there, but it is not typically required in licensure situations that I'm familiar with. I don't know everything, but it's rare.
Okay.
Today.
Let me ask, too, then another basic question. Mr. Sullivan or Ms. Oberton and Mr. Pratt would probably know this since you're operating local systems. If you were to see that a cyber attack is occurring, or you're made note, you had the ransomware attack, right? Who do you go to first? Do you go to Homeland Security? Do you go to your state? I know you went to your, I can't remember what the organization was that helped you solve your problem, but is there a response that's laid out for you to be able to react to something like that?
Under AWIA, we had already had an emergency plan should we be attacked. We received an all printers at 3 a.m. every printer printed out the ransomware demand of $2 million. and told us that we were encrypted. We immediately shut down the entire system. We notified the FBI immediately. We notified FBI, the EPA. We EPA notified our state.
And your state.
We turned to the Water Ice Act to say we were just attacked. How? What do you do?
Right.
Who are the experts? Because cyber is a different thing. Right. None of us are trained in it. Now, all of us know about it. We know about the threats and all that, but what to do.
Right.
So there are experts out there, mm-hmm. and we were able to immediately contact the ISAC, who knew of companies, mm-hmm. who immediately came in and helped us bail out.
Okay. Ms. Overton, if you were to sense something or get something on your printer at 3 o'clock in the morning, who would you go to first?
I think we would contact our state and local governments.
Uh-huh.
It's not necessarily, like this gentleman said, Mr. Sullivan said, it's not directly laid out.
Right.
It's not a training that we've had, or hopefully it's coming forward to let us know as a small and rural area.
Right. Which is my entire state.
Right.
So let me ask you this. You mentioned the Circuit Rider program, which is great for our state.
Yes, absolutely.
Do they have any expertise or any, do they bring anything to the to you on cybersecurity?
Not as of yet,
mm-hmm.
but the tons of educational information, I'm sure that's coming down the pipeline.
Yeah, yeah. Mr. Pratt, do you have anything? Where would you go if you were?
FBI first and uh-huh. the Water Ice Act, plus our state has some support in that area. I do want to echo what Representative Gallagher said, though. Many government agencies have historically viewed IT infrastructure as an optional buy-up versus necessary investment, and we're playing catch-up. And that SCADA marketplace is much less mature on cybersecurity than, say, I even had it written down, the financial or medical
right.
Software market. So my county was hacked, not in our control systems, but they got in and got some HIPAA records, mm-hmm. From an internal type of pathway, and we have had a chief information security officer since that time.
Okay.
And fortunately, I was able to speak with him prior to coming here to yeah. get his insight on things. But FBI, Water ISAC, and state, I'll say CISO agency.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Batt, let's talk about transportation a little bit, because I think obviously with autonomous vehicles and electric vehicles, I mean, actually, I saw a lamp, I call it a lamp post. It was an enormous post that they were going to be installing along one of our major arteries, interstates. And my husband looked over, and he's like, what is on the top of that? Well, it was some kind of sensor. I don't know what it was. It could have been a weather sensor. It could have been a who knows what. But it was something tied to the Internet. It was pretty obvious there. So I think that we're going to see this more and more. It may have been something to sensitize when and how often the light went off and on or whatever. So in transportation, where would a transportation facility go? Because I am the ranking member on Homeland Security on the Appropriations Committee. There's an organization there, CISA, that's mm-hmm. supposed to be helping all state and local in a lot of areas in terms of cybersecurity. We're putting a lot of money into that because I think this could help our circuit riders, it could help our state and locals, it could help everybody. But where would you go in a transportation incident?
So I think that you have correctly identified the major vulnerabilities and many vulnerabilities that exist, because as we introduce more of these sensor systems, active traffic management, VMS signs, variable message board signs, closed circuit television, cameras, tolling systems. These are all potential vectors or entry points.
Right.
And so you want to delineate between sort of operational technologies. There are vulnerabilities like I just listed out. The IT that is in there where somebody's using, opening up a phishing email, and then all the data that is out mm-hmm. there. So, Colorado DOT experienced a ransomware attack. The playbook there was to go to the state resources first, but quickly became apparent that it was a state-sponsored attack, and so we had to bring in federal resources from Colorado Springs, or they did. I was not there at that time, but from Colorado Springs and other places. And so I think that is one of the reasons for providing federal support to bring all of these states and other transportation agencies up to a level playing field. So no matter whether you're the most sophisticated state or one that's just discovering this, you kind of know exactly where to go.
Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Whitehouse, why don't you go ahead? Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Chairman. Thanks to all the witnesses for being here. Just a quick opening question. Ms. Oberden, what federal standards must Del Mar adhere to with regard to cybersecurity?
Whatever is put out there for us to follow. We don't have any specific standards at this point for cybersecurity. We follow...
I think that's my point. Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Sullivan, Boston Water, what federal standards are you obliged to follow regarding cybersecurity?
The only federal requirement was we needed to follow WEA, and we needed to self-certify that we looked at our systems, we came up with a plan, and that's the only standards that I know of.
Mr. Pratt, your county?
No mandates.
So I think that's a pretty open situation. My view of this is that the federal government, by and large, has done a pretty good job of defending its cyber systems. When there is a hack, it's a big one because we have boatloads of info, but by and large, federal agencies have been fairly good. The defense industrial base has done quite a good job at defending itself because it's put under immense pressure by the Department of Defense to make sure that it does defend itself. The financial system is heavily regulated, and as a result, the financial system has done a very good job of defending itself. Local government has very mixed views. The town of East Greenwich in Rhode Island sustained a ransomware hack, but it was prepared. They quickly shut down their systems. They had backups that they could that were current that they could roll right in quickly. They had a disaster recovery plan, and it took a lot of work, but they were able to pay no ransom and get back up and operating and lose no data because they were prepared. Paid no ransom. Because they were prepared, and one of the reasons they were able to do that was because another Rhode Island municipality had very bad luck, and it had to pay, and our Rhode Island State Police cyber unit did a very good job of going and banging on the doors of our 39 municipalities and saying, look, guys, this just happened. Everybody has to be ready, and so that change happened, and East Greenwich was ready and did a very, very good job. The worst place in the country that I can think of right now is privately owned critical infrastructure because they've successfully defended against being under anything other than the voluntary NIST framework program, which is totally voluntary. And it's immensely frustrating to me, having worked in this space since my time on the Intelligence Committee a long time ago, that we've known about ransomware for over a decade, right? We've known that critical infrastructure was the prime target for cyber hackers for more than a decade. We've spent billions of dollars to defend critical infrastructure through Homeland Security, through the Department of Defense and other places. And what did we get? We got a ransomware attack on critical infrastructure and it succeeded. Why people didn't get fired over that, I do not know. But part of the deal has to be that we've got to be less reticent about when a company's critical infrastructure, making sure that they're doing their job of defending themselves. We can't just have the Chamber of Commerce, U.S. Chamber of Commerce, come in here and say, no, we're against all this stuff, and roll over backwards when it's critical infrastructure. So you guys are kind of in the middle. You're not privately owned, but you're not much supported, either with resources or with regulations. And I hope very much that in this committee we'll start to develop things that will help you work through this so you're more like East Greenwich when you get hit. Sounds, Mr. Sullivan, like you all did a pretty good job of getting back online.
We did not pay any ransom. We immediately shut down. We didn't even communicate with them.
Yep.
And we sought the resources. But we had a plan already because we were required to do that. The problem we have with us, we got the ransomware because an employee opened up an email despite the training we had.
Yep.
And it takes constant training, and that's the biggest problem for the large utilities.
Yep.
Cybersecurity, the element of people watching out all the time. Everyone assumes the email comes in, it looks good, looks at open this attachment.
You click the attachment and suddenly they're in.
Yep.
Yeah. If I could mention just one additional thing that doesn't really bear on this committee, but I'm hoping we can get it done bipartisan and maybe even by unanimous consent. Senator Graham, Senator Tillis, Senator Blumenthal, and I have a bill to help with criminal enforcement of people who attack our critical infrastructure. It makes hacking qualify for a bunch of predicates like RICO and money laundering and so forth. it deals with bots and botnets. In my view, there is no good bot and there is no good botnet, but the authority to go after them before they become...
Maybe a Shailen bot.
Before they become, sorry, B-O-T, not B-H-A-T-T. But the authority to go after them before they become actively harmful is unclear, and we need to fix that. And we have a bunch of enhanced penalties that we could add once people go after critical infrastructure. And I'm hoping that's something we can move quickly, unless there's some like botnet caucus out there that I haven't heard about. These are things that the Department of Justice has long asked for, and it would provide some additional backstopping for all of you, because nothing like people going to jail to help knock behavior down. So thank you, Chairman, for drawing our attention to this. Thank you to the ranking member for making this a good bipartisan hearing, and look forward to working with you all on this subject. Terrific witnesses.
Thank you, Senator White. You spent a lot of time on this, and we appreciate very much. Ms. Pratt, I think you shared with us 8 or 9 recommendations from the APWA. Did you do that in your testimony?
We will be providing those in writing. Are you saying you'd like to hear them again?
Yeah, no. You already went through them. And let me just ask you, our other witnesses. I think that may be the first time I've heard those. And are y'all familiar with what he shared with us? The 8. I think there are 8 APWA recommendations were part of your testimony. And I'm just asking your familiarity with those recommendations. Is something y'all have heard of? You're familiar with? Maybe not. Anybody? Ms. Overton, is this something that has come to your attention?
No, not to my attention. No.
Okay. Mr. Sullivan?
Yeah, I heard them, and I would like to add that there needs to be funding for the smaller systems. There's too much pressure between our problems with PFAS, with affordability issues, and the intensity of the existing regulations. People can say they have a problem with their cyber. They need a way to fix them. And the smaller ones have the biggest problem.
All right, thank you. Secretary Bott, is this something you've heard of?
Yeah, obviously from an APWA perspective, it's not a direct analog for transportation, but many of the same principles on the SCADA devices. When he was talking about the bring your own device, this is an issue that affects all of these industries. And so as I was listening, I was thinking there's a lot of... items that we could also support for that as well, mm-hmm. for transportation.
Yeah. Ms. Pratt, I'm going to just walk through those recommendations. I thought they were very good.
Yeah, I'm happy to go through them one more time just to note that our association president and our governor of affairs staff are here and have traded cards with each of the organizations that these folks represent, and we totally understand that we want to be singing from the same hymnal. So the first was to have the federal government sharing threat information and providing interagency technical support to local governments to enhance cybersecurity, perhaps by establishing a voluntary national cybersecurity guidelines. That would help us with that certification and including public works folks and all these organizations in crafting those to supplement that Water Ice Act. The second one was to standardize and utilize important tools to protect these critical assets, so use that cyber lens to maybe get a little more consolidation in that SCADA industry. Third was comprehensive cybersecurity training for me and my peers. I believe this is essential because this, again, as has been said, this is not a thing that no matter how good we are at our technical jobs of physical infrastructure, this is just as new to us as any of you here. We all are trying to hire young staffers. Fourth, please continue to fully fund FEMA's Emergency Management Performance Grant Program. Fifth, let's continue to support asset management. So that really is something that can be done with revolving loan funds. And we want to deliver that best taxpayer value when we do make infrastructure investments. And we want to absolutely make sure that my seventh one was related to that cybersecurity is fundable in any program that flows through this wonderful committee. The sixth one was... talking about that specifically, I guess, so I had those back to back. I'm sorry. My seventh one was more related to taxpayer value. APWA does support lifting the cap on private activity bonds for water infrastructure and restoring the advance refunding of tax-exempt municipal bonds. Again, that will help give us a little bit better interest rates and provide a little more space for that cybersecurity piece of things. Whether that should be 2% or 1%, I'm not an expert, but it needs to be something percent, right, when we invest in intelligent systems. And my last one was just that we hope Congress continues to ensure state and local control regarding public works projects, because locals are experts on their community needs. I'm very sympathetic to Senator Whitehouse's point that perhaps a little bit better checking on how are we doing with cybersecurity and do we know what we're supposed to be doing. So I appreciate the opportunity to restate
that. Yeah, that was worth hearing again, and thank you for sharing them with us. Anybody want to react? The other three witnesses want to react to anything that he's mentioned in those nine recommendations? Please, Secretary Bond.
Yeah, I think that in hearing them again, I think the one thing that jumped out at me that I think is shared from an infrastructure owner-operator perspective, as many of the transportation agencies are, was the comprehensive cyber training. We talk a lot about workforce in transportation and making sure that, you know, we are training people to create a culture of cybersecurity within state DOTs and other transportation agencies. I think that is something that would be valuable to share across all organizations, because we are already tasking them to, you know, be responsible for whatever their core mission is. You can't just then say, in addition to that, also be mindful of cybersecurity. You've got to train that. You've got to create that culture. And so I think that was something that really resonated as well.
All right. Any other reaction? Ms. Overton and then Mr. Sullivan.
In saying that, I would also just say that remember that rural water, these smaller communities, most don't have the opportunity to get the information. So making sure that we hit these small mom and pop communities like the trailer parks and things, making sure that even though we say funding and low interest rates, they may not be able to afford that.
Yeah.
So cybersecurity and training and everything that is necessary should be affordable to them, if not at a free cost, as our Delaware Rural Water, Maryland Rural Water, and National Rural Waters provide that training.
Good. Thank you. Mr. Sullivan, any thoughts?
Yeah, and there are some excellent sources out there. CISID puts out unbelievable stuff. Yesterday, we were alerted that they put another item up on the website about industrial control systems. The problem is people don't have time to go to all these sources and collect them all and see if it pertains to their particular system, which is the reason that I've been emphasizing the Water Rights Act can collect all this. It partners with everybody, EPA, CISR, all federal government, all the associations. We can consolidate and we can get it to the smaller systems, telling them what's important for them. Because it's important that we weed out some of this extraneous stuff. There's so much information out there that our analysts could take a look at it, bring it down, and get it to them. We would just need funding so that we can get to these particular systems, because they can't afford to join the Water Rights Act.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. So we've been joined by Senator Padilla. And hails from a state, the big state where I used to live when I was in the Navy. And we're honored that he's joined us in the Senate and on this committee. Senator Padilla, you're right on time. Go right ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Appreciate the discussion. I'm going to continue in a minute here on the cyber theme that we're discussing right now. But just a little bit of a preface is the former Secretary of State from California, I'm all too familiar with the risks posed by cyber attacks and the importance of security and modernization of our critical infrastructure, whether it's voting systems or water systems, transportation systems, et cetera. And unfortunately, we're getting constant reminders of not just the importance, but the urgency with which we need to act. Just last month, a hacker accessed the computer system of a water treatment plant in California and deleted several programs that are designed and put in place to treat drinking water. Thankfully, the hack did not result in any harm to the public, but again, the most recent reminder of the importance and the urgency with which we need to act. Solar winds not that long ago, the Colonial Pipeline, on and on and on. We've begun the discussion, but if I can ask just Mr. Sullivan maybe for a few more thoughts on what role should municipalities play in preparing their employees for this now constant stream of phishing emails and now text, phishing text messages, other efforts to undermine security systems that are in place, and what else the government, federal government can do? I heard you reference CISA. If there's anything else that they're not doing that you think they could and should be doing to add value for state and local governments or system operators, that'd be helpful.
Yeah, I think the most important thing is that they have to play a role in testing and with their own employees, what happens if we were attacked, if this is shut down? Who do you contact? How do you contact them? One of the things that goes on at our facility now is that randomly each week, 20 employees get phishing emails from the IT department, and we test to see who hits them. And invariably, somebody opens up an email. And they do very well at massaging them, making them look real. Some of them look like their bank account. Some of them look like you just won a prize. Some of them, and yet people still fall for it. So one of the things that has to be done is the culture that cyber is very important, and you can bring down an entire city if you're not careful. We also now limit what people can do with their computers. It used to be wide open. People would bring in their own USBs, hook them in to download. You can't do that anymore. We totally shut that off. We do not allow people to use their own private phones in order to access any of the, which we used to before. That's shut down. You've got to use a commission. It's got double authentication on it. So we have really tightened it up.
And even some of those latter dynamics complicated by the COVID pandemic with a lot of more remote working, for example. So whether it's a personal device versus an official device, how you're accessing private networks, et cetera, cyber hygiene, constant training of employees. These tabletop exercises led by DHS in the election space, we found tremendously helpful and important. Like you're saying, running through simulation exercises, what if, what if, what if, so that staff top to bottom is best prepared in the event of a threat or the event of an actual incident. I didn't mean to cut you off there, but I want to make sure that in my limited time, I raise a specific question as it pertains to some of the smaller and rural systems, particularly in water in different parts of the country. Organizations like the Rural Community Assistance Corporation, which is a nonprofit organization based in West Sacramento, provides training and technical assistance to tribal and rural communities across California and in 13 other western states. Now, small and rural water systems face particular challenges in operating water systems since income from a small population of ratepayers may not be enough to cover the actual providing the water service itself, let alone a robust cybersecurity infrastructure. So these challenges are obviously compounded by the drastic reduction in federal funding in water infrastructure in over the course of several years. So, Ms. Oberton, how can Congress ensure small and rural water systems are not left behind and that underserved communities served by these systems are also protected from cyber threats?
I think by making sure that the information is out there. Again, I speak to the small rural areas like we live in. And if we know it's there and the training is available and easily funded, then it won't be such a burden for our rural community. Sometimes we have people that have a trailer park. Like I spoke earlier, you have a community of 25 or 30 people, but they don't get the information like we get it. So it's very important that however we get it out there, those communities and our small communities are recognized. And we do that through our rural water associations.
Mr. Chair, I know my time's expired. If I could just squeeze in one more question.
No, I can't.
Transportation.
No, I can't. I'm sorry. I skipped over Senator Bozeman.
That's what I'll say.
I'll come back to you as soon as, but he needs to be someplace else. So
it's
if
okay,
you'll just
Mr.
let.
It's okay. Let you, go ahead.
Are you sure?
All right, go ahead.
And I'll just be briefly, please. Thank you.
Just want to recognize that continued research, development, and deployment of smart infrastructure and automated vehicle technologies has the potential to save lives, right, to reduce congestion and emissions and improve equity and economic growth. That's why when I was in the state senate in California, I authored the law to provide for the safe operation of autonomous vehicles in California. But we've also seen an increased connected transportation system raise new challenges like cyber threats. As with other sectors, we must ensure that transportation agencies are equipped to handle these threats and prevent disruptions to critical infrastructure. Mr. Butt, you know, given your experience as a state and federal official, what resources do transportation agencies uniquely need to protect infrastructure from these threats and to promote a safer, cleaner, more efficient transportation system?
Thank you, Senator Padilla. In fact, all of your words are consistent with the mission of our organization at ITS America. And in fact, the California Department of Transportation is a CALSTA is a member. David Kim sits on our Secretary Kim sits on our board of directors. And I think what is really important in terms of what is needed is just, you know, getting all of the states, all of the agencies up to the standards so that everybody's on a level playing field. Because you can't have a vehicle, whether it's driven by a human or in the future autonomous vehicles, drive from California to New York and go through 20 different jurisdictions and have 20 different protocols. So I think that what would be great from a federal perspective is the funding. I've had lots of conversations with USDOT. I think they get the severity. The president had an executive order on cybersecurity. Committees like EPW showing the importance of cybersecurity and infrastructure. I think there is the opportunity for leadership and then providing the funding, because state DOTs have so many other things that they have to do that you can't make cybersecurity one of the things that they have to pick between. You've got to provide the funding, and I really appreciate the efforts of this committee to make that funding eligible.
Okay, thanks. Thank you, Senator Padilla. All right, Senator Bozeman, please excuse me, for skipping over before.
Oh, no.
You're very kind, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for being so gracious.
I apologize for being late.
You're recognized for the next 30 minutes.
I apologize for being late and having to sneak out. There's about six hearings going on all at the same time right now. But thank you, Mr. Chairman, for having this really important, timely hearing.
I wish I could say it was my idea. It's actually Senator Capito's idea. So we're happy,
well,
happy you're
here. It's a joint venture, as always. So, Mr. Sullivan, in your testimony, you stated that larger utilities with more resources have fewer challenges to implement cybersecurity practices, while many smaller utilities lack funding and expertise. In your opinion, is this an issue of a lack of resources and tools for small and medium systems, or is a lack of awareness of the tools already available? And are there any recommendations to help promote available tools among the smaller providers who often have fewer resources, dollars, and people than the larger entities, or do we need to actually do something in addition?
I think the biggest problem is a lack of awareness. I'm not sure if the smaller systems, if they have a system that's running and working and they hear someone else get attacked and they just say, who's going to attack me? But they don't know the vulnerability. They don't really know how it could be. So lack of awareness is, I think, the biggest problem. And then once they are aware of it, they need to be able to take a look at it and say, what would it take for me to do it? It may be inexpensive. A couple of minor adjustments could be okay. But in many cases, I think people are dealing with legacy systems. They put them in, they work fine. There hasn't been any patches to the industrial control systems, the devices that have been sitting there. No one's looked at them for security purposes. And that's where the real problem lies. And I think we need to educate them, make them aware, and then, in some cases, get them funding to replace them.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Mr. Pratt, how do you balance cybersecurity with functionality? What types of water resources infrastructure should be prioritized?
When I go through the pecking order, I think of, as far as the prioritization goes, I think of large holding ponds of contaminated water are probably a very high priority. Drinking water systems, sewage systems, and drainage and flood control are certainly important. That's the core of my operation, but the ability for that to cause harm to a wide range of people is somewhat limited, because generally the hazards are as related to weather as anything else. As to how to balance those, what I talk to my team about, I've got about 725 miles of infrastructure, three dams, a whole bunch of other odds and ends that go along with that, and I got a team of about a dozen people that work on that. What I talk to people about every day is you need to decide what you're not going to do today, because we don't have the bandwidth. And a small, many of these small operations, that 89% that's very small utilities, you might have a single operator with a license who is the licensed operator for three of those facilities. That person is not there every day, and that person is relying even more when they have the opportunity on the remote side of things. So as Mr. Sullivan said, being able to thin out, weed out, and provide a direct push information to folks about stuff in their particular situation that would be the most important to deal with cybersecurity is the most important thing, I think, because it's really difficult to balance that. The pressures of day-to-day operations are difficult. And I think the last thing I would say regarding upping everybody's game, we've all mentioned the tens of thousands of agencies there. And, you know, in cybersecurity, you don't have to be faster than the bear. You just got to be faster than everybody else. There's a lot of weak links is the problem. And those links can be connected, and they all affect people. Even if it's only one of 56 or 70,000 agencies, however many we want to say there are, public and private, just one of those, that can cause a real stir publicly that creates pressure. So there's the stick approach, but there's also the carrots. Asset management is an excellent way to ensure that local units of government who have pressure to not raise rates are looking to do regular investing and having a long-range plan, and having what Canada does is our friends at the Canadian Public Works, they gave out $180 billion to municipalities. They announced it in 2016. And these folks require you to be eligible for a grant to, number one, you have to show how you're going to take care of the new stuff or the old stuff you're fixing. And you have to stick to that plan, or you've got to give that grant money back. My last point would be forgiveness for cybersecurity would be a wonderful thing to weave into all of the programs. Just let's put a carrot out there along with whatever sticks you folks think is necessary. I appreciate the question, sir.
Thank you, and thanks to the panelists, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you again for your patience and for being so gracious. All right. Senator Cardin.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, and let me thank all four of our witnesses. And I am very proud of the work of our committee in providing the resources, and I appreciate the acknowledgments today, to allow our public works to have the capacity to respond to current challenges. So we very much appreciate your testimony. We appreciate this hearing on cybersecurity challenges. So I would want to first welcome Mrs. Overton to our committee. Thank you for your service in Del Mar, particularly on the Maryland side of that particular community. I have a running battle with the chairman. I really think that we should be calling it Mardell, but he will not allow us to change the name of the city. But anyway, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I want to just talk a little bit about the challenges that we have in our rural communities and public works. You've mentioned some, but the rate base is challenging for people to be able to afford their water. You have a broadband access issue in rural communities. You have a climate change challenge that you're now trying to deal with. So as we talk about being able to deal with the challenges of cybersecurity or the challenges of these other issues, let's talk a little bit about the local capacity and how much it's important for partnerships with the state and federal government.
I think that we do very well with having those partnerships. I think that it would be more necessary for yourself and chairman and people to come down and see. I think what happens is when we look at the larger positions, people don't see what's going on in our small towns. And to know and to walk through and get the feel of what we actually go through from on a day-to-day basis. In small areas, you don't have enough employees to cover some of the day-to-day things that need to get done. We have to prioritize, and some things that need to get done get pushed back on the back burner, maybe because of funding, because we just don't have it. So I think that when you look at the local government, the state government, and the federal government, you need to come down off that chair and come see what it's really going on in our areas and sit down and have conversations and know what specific needs are, because each utility is different. Each utility is not the same. We don't offer the same. We don't, you know, do the same thing. So I think that's very important.
So I have visited the facilities in our rural areas as well as our urban centers. And as I look at current challenges, climate change has really presented a challenge for our water infrastructure. We have invested billions and billions of dollars to deal with the impact of climate change, whether it's storm runoff issues, erosion issues, pollution issues. And in rural communities, the problems might be big, but your rate group is small. So these issues become magnified in communities that don't have the same fiscal capacity as our larger jurisdictions have. So could you just share with us how you go about dealing with those types of challenges that are becoming more pronounced as we are dealing with the realities?
Well, we're grateful for the funding that you guys provide for us. And so we make it a priority to figure out what needs to happen first. And our I&I is first on the list, because it's causing problems not only with our water, but also with the sewer. And that's where a lot of our money goes, and trying to keep our rates down so our residents can be comfortable is a challenge. But when you have old terracotta pipes, you got to fix them or you're going to continue to have issues. So I think funding is very important, and we are grateful for the funding that you guys have given us. I mean, it's absolutely necessary for small town communities like ourselves.
Well, again, I want to thank all of our witnesses, and I can tell you this committee is very mindful of your challenges, and we work together in a very strong bipartisan way, and we'll continue to do that.
Thanks for joining us, Senator Cardin. We've been joined by Senator Markey. Senator Markey, I don't know if you know John Sullivan. There's several John Sullivans in Massachusetts, but this is an extraordinary person, and his little years of service rivals our own. So that's saying a lot.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I will tell you something about the Sullivans. My mother is a Sullivan.
No.
And my mother always would say the Sullivans are a superior group of people. So Mr. Sullivan just reflects this whole tradition of superior Sullivans, and she had an Uncle John Sullivan, and we may be related, although John Sullivan is, you know, not the most uncommon name in Boston, I would say. There's a lot of Jack Sullivans and Jake Sullivans and J.J. Sullivans to distinguish all of themselves, but this Sullivan, just from his testimony thus far, is clearly...
He's good. Yeah. He's first rate.
On the other hand, my mother was afraid that that had been watered down by the other side of the family. And she used to say that, Eddie, your father and I, we're gonna donate your brain to Harvard Medical School as a completely unused human organ. You know, you're part Sullivan. Learn how to work smarter and not harder. So Mr. Sullivan, we might need a translator so that people can understand what we're saying to each other. Is it a matter of money? You just need money to be able to invest in the technologies which are needed to protect against cyber attacks?
Well, there is money needed. However, the larger cities are able to, because of their workforce and because of their rate base, are able to take care of most of the issues that are facing them. What they need is more information, timely information. They need to know about the innovations others are using, so that they can implement them. And those are the larger, greater than 100,000 cities. When you get down smaller, there are so many competing interests on the smaller groups, including the affordability issue that's on their rate base, that they've got to look at, is climate change more important now? Is the flooding that's occurring? What about a wildfire? Where do I put my resources?
Can I ask a question? In this modern era, is it just part of the cost of doing business? In other words, there's there's a Dickensian quality to the internet. It's the best of technologies and the worst of technologies simultaneously. The best of technologies can, like, make so much money that we have a race to go to outer space amongst all the people who made a lot of money. But then you leave behind these unattended to problems, which also exist, which is the vulnerability of every device which we use and all these utilities. So do you think that our consciousness in the country has to just switch to the fact where you get the benefits of it, on the one hand, as a municipality, you know, but at the same time, you have to just up what you're willing to pay in order to protect against the sinister side of cyberspace? Or should the federal government be providing the funding, or state governments, to those smaller communities especially?
Well, I think we may be in a catch-up mode, because we all went to this great technology, and it was wonderful in the 90s, and we could actually do more with less, because we could use technology. But no one worried about, is someone bad out there going to take me down with this? So now we're in a point, yes, someone is going to take you down. And the catch-up, so the bigger cities, like I mentioned, have been taking care of their problems. The little ones are just stymied. First, they don't even know what the problems are. So we've got to get more resources to them and let them understand what's wrong. And some of them may need additional funds. I can't speak for every utility and how they'd get it, or what their infrastructure needs are, or their sewer overflows, or others.
Okay, so you're just saying we have to provide the resources to those smaller communities.
Yes.
And maybe ensure on a regional basis that there's an ongoing educational process for those communities, so they're brought up to speed and know that this risk is real, because we're deep into it now. You know, all around the world, they can see what they can do to the Quabbin Reservoir, to other facilities. So thank you for that, Mr. Batt. I have a piece of legislation, the Security and Privacy in Your Car Act, or the Spy Car Act. I've introduced that with Senator Blumenthal, and the chairman has been good enough to include it in the surface transportation bill approved by this committee. And what that legislation does is it instructs the Federal Highway Administration to create a cybersecurity tool and appoint a cyber coordinator that will help transportation authorities identify, detect, protect against, and respond to and recover from cyber incidents. Do you support that legislation moving forward and passing this year so that the Federal Highway Administration has that instruction and those tools to begin to implement?
Yes, Senator Markey, I know you've been very passionate on this issue. And to me, I think the whole tone and tenor of this hearing is about the need for federal leadership in cybersecurity. And so to the extent that Federal Highways has more resources, the only caveat I would say is just making sure that whatever USDOT or Federal Highways is doing is tied in with DHS, to make sure that, you know, that they're all working in coordination.
No, thank you. And I was the chair of the Energy and Environment Subcommittee in the House back in 2009, 2010. The FBI, CIA, they all came to me. They said, we have a great vulnerability in our utility sector. We can be attacked at any time. So I work with Congressman Upton. We got the bill passed and on the floor to mandate that utilities had to upgrade, mandate, okay? And we could give them some assistance. And what happened here over in the Senate, a single senator, actually from Arizona, just put a hold on that bill and killed it. That was now 11 years ago. You know, otherwise, we would have already had a mandate out there that utilities have to do something about this. So my own belief is that it's not a new issue. The CIA and FBI wouldn't have been coming to me in 2009 if it was a new issue. They said their hair was on fire 12 years ago, okay? So it's an issue that just hasn't had the funding or attention paid to it, and I started with just looking at the utilities. They just don't like the cost of doing it, okay? It's not like it's some mystery that they're the only ones who don't read the front page and say these facilities are vulnerable, or China or Iran or North Korea are attacking them, okay? It's all out there in the public domain, And so I just think it becomes kind of the job of the government to say, you have to do it, we'll help to fund it for you, but otherwise we're going to have a catastrophe. And I'm so glad that we're having this hearing. And I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for including in the surface transportation bill my spy car legislation. I hope we can get that deal out on the floor in the next week or so, because I think those tools are going to help, especially in the automotive sector, where these things are just computers on wheels. You know, and the internet is now in the in the red light. It's in the all the traffic control systems. There's so many pathways in now to kind of disrupt our way of life. And as people drive these autonomous vehicles, just some kid sitting on his bed wants to just stop playing games. He won't have to be on an overpass anymore, throwing a rock at a car. You just do it from sitting in a car and sitting in his living room and create a disaster. So I thank you, Mr. Chairman, for your help in including that legislation. Thank you, Mr.
Happy to do it. Thank you. Thank you. Spy car. I like that. Spy car. I have some questions I want to ask now, and I think Senator Capito may have an additional question or two, and then I think we're going to wrap at that point in time. Coming back to Secretary Bott, question with respect to interoperability and cybersecurity. The, as I'm sure you're aware from your experience both at the state level, Colorado and in Delaware, and at the federal level of transportation, when looking to address a national problem, there's no one-size-fits-all solution. And in your testimony, you state that a national strategy that extends to state and local transportation agencies will be the key to helping address some, not all, but some of these vulnerabilities. And my question would be, given that every state and local agency is not on the same level of technical expertise, as we've been reminded here today, as well as a financial capability, how do you suggest that we get just about everybody to an agreed to baseline that will not prevent interoperability between systems already in place?
Well, thank you, Senator, and again, just really appreciate the committee's focus on this issue. I think that there are efforts underway in this space. I mean, we talked about USDOT and their focus. AASHTO has a committee on transportation system security and resilience and also transportation system operations that is trying to bring everybody up to a baseline. From a federal perspective, based on my experience, the way I think I would approach this would be to say, let's make the funding 100% eligible from a federal perspective, as we do for many of the safety programs. And then the playbook that I would recommend is the NIST framework for all of the stakeholders. And, their framework for cybersecurity talks about identifying the threats to your system, protecting against those vulnerabilities, detecting attacks on your system, responding to them, and then recovering. So we've heard even on the water side how folks have been able to respond quickly if they've got the proper backups, if they've got segmentation of their systems. And so I think the simple answer is just have all of these agencies by a date, come back and say, yes, we've adopted the NIST framework. And then you have to walk before you run. And that would get everybody walking, and then we can kind of have a level playing field.
All right, good. Thank you. Mr. Sullivan, a question for you, if I could. If the federal government provided funding assistance to support the water information sharing and analysis center's operations, Water ISAC, what expanded services would the center be able to offer?
Well, we would work with our partner agencies, the EPA, et cetera, to identify all the agencies that needed us, all the water utilities, et cetera. We already work with them and partners with CISR, et cetera. We would take that information they have and boil it down so it's understandable to our audience. They put out a ton of information all over the place, a plethora of information on IT. We would take it and make it so that people would understand it, how it impacts their system. With that knowledge, we would do additional training. We would have the training that's available already through either a national association so that we could publicize that to them. Because not every operator knows all of this is out there. So we would centralize it, put it to them through daily alerts, weekly alerts, monthly. In addition, we have a huge library of all types of information, including chemical analysis and what do you do when. And we'd be able to direct resources when there was a response. They could call the ISAC, and we could put them in touch with subject matter experts.
All right, thank you. A question, if I could, for all of our witnesses, and dealing with cross-modal integration. As we've seen and heard in this hearing today, cybersecurity is not an issue that exists in one singular place or in one specific mode of transportation. How do we ensure that as we look to address these ever-growing vulnerabilities, we do so in a way that addresses all modes of infrastructure, including transportation. And Secretary Bott, would you go first on this one, and then we'll ask the others to comment if they wish.
Yes, and I think that that is part of the challenge in transportation and for all of these different agencies is we've historically been very siloed, right? So our buses are part of our transit system, our trains are part of our rail system, and highways operate independently. And the problem is, as you get into this IoT environment, the cameras that are providing feeds into a transportation management center are also receiving signals from buses that are relying on traffic signals to move to optimize that bus route. You've got micromobility coming in, scooters and automated vehicles. And so it is incredibly important that, and again, this is part of the discussions we've had with USDOT, is how do you bring all of these disparate modes? They have the ITS Joint Program Office is providing a lot of leadership in this space, but it is critical that we do not view this as mode by mode, but as a system of systems. And I think that that is really critically important to these efforts.
All right, thank you. Any of our other witnesses want to comment on this question? You don't have to, but if you'd like to, go ahead. Mr. Pratt.
I just have a comment to just make an analogy, just kind of looking around at maybe our average age profile. I remember when it was real, you wondered if the printer was going to print the thing, right? When they first had printers and the software didn't talk to each other and everything was all goofed up. So I just want to kind of bring that down to the more simple analogy of eventually that got figured out. And now you know, like my computer's going to automatically find the nearby printer, let me know which ones. And it's getting those sort of protocols and standardization where even if we've got a ramshackle set of connections of five different pieces of software, their ability to connect securely to each other quickly without the users having to be some sort of brilliant IT scientist, that's the direction and that's where we need to head. And I believe like in the transportation systems in my neighborhood is the American Center for Mobility, which one of their primary missions, right, it's a federal testing center to attempt to provide more and more standardization. And I tease the fellows there and the ladies there of like, well, geez, the headlight thing's in a different place on every car. Good luck with getting all the computer stuff to work out. But just a more plain-spoken way of trying to say for all of us, just back in the day of printers, we need to get in that direction where the software is going to figure it out, but we're also secure. And I think that second part's a lot trickier than it was in the day of printers.
Okay. Anyone else before I yield to Senator Capito?
One real comment would be the water systems are all independent. We all use the same equipment. We all do the same type of work and similar. But we don't interconnect like your electrics, like your communications, like your transportation systems across the board. We deal in a turf and a territory individually. But we need standards so that we all know how we all should be taking care of our same type of equipment. And we don't necessarily have those exacting standards. The bigger companies do. The bigger cities do. But the smaller ones, they don't know what the standards are.
All right. Senator Capito, go right ahead, and then I'm going to ask one or two more questions, and we'll be done.
Thank you. Thank you all very much. I think this has been a great hearing and eye-opening in some ways because the challenges, but also some of the gaps. And we know this is an issue that's it's going to grow. It's not like it's going to shrink and go away. We know it's going to grow. So I thank you for being in the arena. I did say I thought Mr. Pratt when you went to the average age of the of the folks in the room, one of the concerns that I've had and that we have actually in our water bill is the next generation workforce. For some reason, this career, which I think is very obviously Mr. Sullivan's been in it for a very long time, holds a lot of promise to, raise your family with and to have great expertise and respect. As you all do in your community, for some reason our younger generation is not getting in there, and we're getting a lot. I know in our state of West Virginia, a lot of people are aging out; they want to retire, but to find replacements has been really, really difficult. So, I'm hoping that by shining a light on how folks have managed their systems for so long, because I think Miss Oberton said 70,000 rural water systems. I mean, it's a lot of people. It's a lot of jobs. I just have one question of Mr. Bott, and I had to step out a bit, so I don't know if this got addressed in any way. Obviously, we've got a lot of big internet companies that gather a lot of data, and that's a subject for a whole bigger debate. I'm not asking you to have that debate. I was just wondering if there is any, are there any ideas on the table to partner with some of these private technology entities to be able to help meet the challenges, not just on the prevention, but also on the detection and other areas of cybersecurity. Are you aware of any of those?
Yes, Senator Capito. And I think one thing on the workforce piece, I think this is incredibly important because, state DOTs, I remember in my time having to struggle to compete for mechanics.
Right.
Because, we would pay a certain wage and private sector companies would pay more. Well, that problem is exacerbated on the technology side. And I think this idea of creating these workforce cultures is really important, and I would look forward to working on that. From a large internet perspective, we have Google and AWS that are members of ITS America. And what used to happen was, sort of back in the printer day, was you're talking about one device. Now you introduce the cloud. And so, and something that Mr. Pratt said, the more handoffs, the more fumbles. I think that is critical to working with those partners to ensure that as data is going from a vehicle to the infrastructure, up to the cloud, back, and lots of handoffs, working with those technology partners to ensure that all levels and layers are secure is really important.
All right. Thank you. I'm going to go vote.
Do you want to make any of the closing statements on this hearing?
I just thank you, Mr. Chairman, and you all. I think this has been a really good hearing, and I don't think we'll just have to keep the conversation going.
Amen. Thanks. Thanks again to you and your staff for bringing up the idea and for making it real. One last question, if I could, for Mr. Pratt. One of the things you said was it more handoffs, more fumbles. People will say to me, my wife will say to me, what did you learn today at this hearing? I said, I got a great line from a guy from Michigan.
Yeah, actually the term would be knock-ons, but since nobody else here probably plays rugby, I just went with the old football thing. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Pratt, it's clear that the challenges on cybersecurity vary from large communities to smaller communities. And as I said earlier, to Mr. Sullivan, but even within community categories, a one-size-fits-all approach may not be the best way to effectively manage and to address cybersecurity threats. And my question of you, Mr. Pratt, would be, aside from funding, what primary role should the federal government play in addressing cybersecurity so that the solutions are flexible but also effective?
You've hit the nail on the head, certainly. Flexibility, but we've got a lot of variety and diversity out there. So how do we get standardization at the same time as flexibility? I'd say I'm going to go with two most important things off of that list that we provided. One is that clearinghouse type of concept that Mr. Sullivan has talked about. How can we help filter so that rural water really has got something that is cleaned up that they can push out to folks, and at the same time, agencies that are working more on the large scale have messaging that's more tailored to them? And then it's that training. How do we get the training to acknowledge some of that need for standardization and having people recognize that we're in the process of moving forward. The thing about working with the private sector, I think the companies have quit calling me, but the market is so dispersed in the water infrastructure. It's a low barrier to entry to start up to do electronic sensing and controls. So I would say my first 5 years in office, I probably got two or three calls a week from various different companies about, hey, would you buy our doohickey to help you do measure things, monitor things, control things. So I'm sure I heard from a good 50, 60 different companies. It's a very fractured market is my point.
All right, thank you. I'm just going to ask, sometimes I do when we have a minute or two at the end of the hearing, I will ask the panel, just is there one thing you'd like to add or really reiterate? So just very briefly, one more thing. You can come back to something you've already said yourself. You heard someone else say that you think it's worth repeating. Just something you'd like to underline, put an exclamation point behind. Ms. Overton, would you do that, please?
I just think that it's very important that the training and the accessibility for the rural areas for the cybersecurity be a top priority, because we make up majority of the water systems across the country.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Sullivan?
I know you've heard me say many times that we need to get to the Water Rights Act to be the central. I want to reiterate that the Water Rights Act was formed for physical security problems in 2002. We then developed all hazards, and now we're working deeper in the cyber. So anybody that joins it gets not only the cyber issues, but they get to all the hazard and all the climate change issues and everything else. It's all available already, and we have it, you know, selected just for the water and wastewater systems.
Thank you, sir. Secretary Vaught, a last closing thought.
Yeah, I would say that the transportation system in the United States was what allowed us to quote-unquote win the 20th century. And there's a lot of negotiations now about a generational investment that you all are trying to make. And I think cybersecurity is an incredibly important part of ensuring that this digital confluence of physical infrastructure and digital layer overlay is secure so that we can have 21st century infrastructure that helps us win the 21st century.
Mr. Pratt, one last thing you'd like to emphasize.
I'm going
to
echo Mr. Sullivan that Water ISAC is wonderful. It is an association of associations. It does connect somewhat at the federal level, but a little bit more input in that direction would really help. And I say my county is 370,000, but it's 40% rural. I can ride a bicycle 15 minutes from where I live in Ann Arbor, any direction, and be in a cornfield. So we've got several rural operators in our area. And, you know, I made the note of I need to really talk to all and reach out to all those folks about the Water ISAC Act, because it's got great stuff for them.
Thank you all. I presume you all have stores called Home Depot, not too far from where you live. And their ad campaign for years says, you can do it, we can help. And when I think of responsibilities that we have to the people we're privileged to serve and represent across the country, it's a shared responsibility. The federal government can't do everything. States can't be all on the states, can't be on the local governments or school districts, can't be all on nonprofits and so forth. But you can do it, we can help. And when you think about what the federal government might be doing a little better job at, we might want to put some emphasis to be a good partner. What comes to mind, just briefly, Mr. Pratt?
As a federal government partner, I'm going to take a little bit of a different tack and go back to the asset management piece of things and start to, you know, it would be great to see asset management as a lot more carrot there, and having that whole cybersecurity is a part of keeping your stuff in good shape. Whether you've got leaky pipes or bumpy roads or signals that aren't optimized, at the end of the day, asset management is a mindset that requires quite a bit of training, just like cybersecurity, but it's really no different than having that maintenance schedule for your car. Everybody does the oil changes, but a lot of people say, well, that brake job's a lot. How long can I wait? But it seems like America's infrastructure has been treated like, I'm going to buy a car and I'll drive it until the brakes fail, and then we'll see what happens next. And that's really the situation we're in. So encouraging that asset management mindset and helping us develop workforce in that area is one of the best things I believe the federal government could do. And federal governments in most of the Commonwealth countries are a good 5 to 10, 15 years ahead of the U.S. in that.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Secretary?
I would say that one thing that the federal government is really good at doing is focusing attention on issues and then providing resources. And so to me, this hearing, the efforts going on with the administration and other committees, I think it's an ability to bring focus and then an ability to bring funding. And I think that the making the cybersecurity eligible, great first step. And now we need to identify funds so that these organizations that have to make tough choices don't have to choose between cybersecurity and potholes and other things. So asset management, incredibly important. But if you want the cybersecurity, that's what the federal government can be play a critical role in.
Great, thank you. Mr. Sullivan, how can we better help at the federal level?
Well, I believe all of us have the same goal, and that is to improve the lives of the American people. the water utility to protect the public health of the American people, and we have a responsibility to do what we can. We're a little bit behind the eight ball, and right now we need to catch up. And so what we need is a little more guidance on the rules. So we have a set of rules across the board, not regulations that you must mandate, because they're going to be outdated by the time we pass them, because the technology is moving faster than we are. So what we need is a little more guidance like that and funding where it's needed. There is a responsibility at the local level to do what you can do, but some people don't have that resource. And so we could work with the federal government and partner with everyone, as we should on all things we do.
Thank you. Ms. Overton?
I think the federal government could help with providing us with more circuit riders, that type of assistance to that can be targeted towards the cybersecurity and focus that specifically to each water community for the rural areas.
Say that last sentence again.
Say again.
Well, your last, just repeat your last sentence.
Having more circuit riders come out to train us on the cybersecurity and it be specific for our particular needs.
All right, thank you. I want to thank you for coming today. I want to thank your mom for having your back, and Mr. Sullivan, Secretary Bott, and Mr. Pratt. Thank you. Thank you all. I want to thank Senator Capito again and her team, working with my team and others to plan for this hearing and to hold this hearing. I want to thank you for your time and for your testimony, too. Today, I said earlier, cybersecurity is constantly evolving challenge. Much like climate change, there's no silver bullet, no single policy or one-time solution to address the cyber threats to our nation's critical infrastructure. I like to say there's no silver bullet, a lot of silver BBs. Some are bigger than others. But my hope is that today's hearing will shed some light on the urgent need to protect our physical infrastructure and will help spur further action as we consider infrastructure legislation. And for some, just a little bit of final housekeeping, I'd like to ask unanimous consent to submit for the record a number of reports and articles relating to today's hearing. Hearing no objection, it's awarded. Additionally, senators will be allowed to submit questions for the record through close of business on August the 4th. We'll compile those questions, we'll send them out to our witnesses and ask our witnesses to reply by August 18th, which was my mother's birthday and her mother's birthday. How about that? And the last thing I'd say, my mother was a deeply religious woman, and she's always reminding my sister and my sister and I to take seriously the admonition of Matthew 25, which starts off with, "When I was thirsty, did you give me to drink?" And when you guys are up at the heavenly gates and trying to get in, talking to St. Peter, and he says, "What did you do about making sure people had some healthy water to drink and so forth?" You can say, "We did a pretty darn good job," and they'll let you in. Thank you all. With that, this hearing is adjourned. Thank you.